So Reed's going to come and speak this morning to us. If you don't know Reed and Stephanie, some of you may not know them. They lead our youth ministry here at the church, and they're incredible people, and I'm very grateful for both of them. They are they're learners. They're learners who always want to grow in their walk with Jesus. They're leaders who care a lot about the youth of our church and our community, and they're invested. They're the type of people who love Jesus passionately, who want to serve him fully with everything that they have. And we're very blessed to have you guys in our church, have you leading our youth. And so would you come this morning? And Stephanie, would you, he's not asleep. Okay, so stand up so everybody can kind of see you. And now we all clap for Stephanie because she's sitting there. This is what happens when you speak somewhere and you bring your wife. She has to stand, and yeah, it's like a rite of passage. Well, it's different when you're at a game. Really excited to hear Reed speak this morning. And kids, we're gonna have you guys stay in here this morning with us. So while he's getting set, we've got our treat bags here for worship. So kids, if you want to come up and grab those, you can all come grab your bag. You got a coloring sheet, you got a snack, you got all that kind of stuff right there. I'll let you guys grab that while Reed's getting set here this morning.
Can I have one? Oh, I'm on.
You're on.
I'm hot.
You're ready to go?
All right.
All right, everybody come grab one. Got plenty up here. If there is any left over, we'll let Reed have one, but like I said, I am really glad that we have such quality leaders. We have a lot of great things going on here at the church, and one of them that I am really excited of, really proud of, is the work that Reed and Stephanie do with our youth. And I've asked him today if he would speak on this topic, and then he's formed the message from there. And so he's going to share from his heart. But I want you to hear about discipleship today, and I want you to hear about it from Reed, because he is a person who really does live out being a disciple, both being discipled and wanting to make disciples, as you'll hear about this morning. And so I'm gonna lead us in a prayer over you and your message this morning, and just ask the Lord's blessing. Would you join me this morning? Father, we thank you for your love for us. I thank you for this man standing here, my friend, that has been willing, Lord, to step up and proclaim your word today in this context. I just ask that you would anoint him and bless him, Lord. The message that he's prepared from your word, I know it will be encouraging to our hearts. I know it will be challenging to our hearts. And so I pray that for every one of us in this room, Lord, you would give us ears to hear, hearts to understand, Lord, that we would hear from you through the preaching of your word this morning through our brother. And we ask your spirit to rest upon him in this time. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Well, good morning, church family. Like Pastor said, when he extended the invitation to me to speak, I was excited to get to speak to my church. I wasn't really surprised that I was excited to get to speak, because as my wife is always quick to tell me, Reed, you sure do love to talk. That's true. First off, I don't claim to, nor should I ever claim to, be a pastor. The office of pastor is something that few are called to do. My wife and I often talk about the weight that must be felt by Pastor Jess and all pastors. I often lose sleep over a lost basketball game, whereas pastors lose sleep over lost souls. I admire the dedication of Bible-believing and preaching pastors. I admire our pastor. The true preaching of the Word of God is something that is under attack from within the church as a whole, but that's a message for another day. To begin today, I do want to pose a question. And the question is, why am I about to share a message centered around the gospel? After I just told you, I am not, nor do I ever really wish to be, a pastor. What in the world is the point of me speaking to you today? Before I answer that, let me quickly prove to you just how unqualified I truly am. Most of you know me pretty well. I was born on November 21st, 1995. So since November 26th, 1995, I've spent the overwhelming majority of my Sundays sitting in the same pew halfway up the right side of the sanctuary. I do guess after I got married, my wife made me move up a pew or two. But the point is, the bulk of my training as a Christian has come from that pew, from the hearing of the word preached week in and week out. It has been that, or Sunday school, or youth group, or various small groups that I've been involved in, but that's it. I hold no degree. Those that know me know I can barely speak English, and I certainly can't read Greek or Hebrew. So I ask again, why am I speaking today? The reason that I'm speaking to you today about the gospel of Jesus Christ is because the work done on the cross has made me, through no merit of my own, a disciple of Jesus. And this is what disciples of Jesus are called to do, to share. This is the reason all born-again believers should be speaking about the good news of the gospel. Matthew 28, 19 through 20, I'm sure a lot of you know it, makes it very clear. Jesus says, "Go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." So with that in mind, this morning I'm going to speak to you about the topic of discipleship. Now before I go any further, I need to be really clear on this point. And I'm going to steal one of my favorites of pastor's analogies that he often uses. A disciple of Christ is someone that has put their faith in Christ alone. One who believes in Christ's finished work on the cross and accepts his gifts of salvation. Simply put, a disciple is a Christian. And it's important to understand that there's no varsity or JV disciples. There are just disciples of Christ and lost sinners. Everything I talk about moving forward in regards to discipleship applies to anyone that has placed their faith in Christ for salvation from sin. We can be confident in this truth based on Scripture. For example, look at Acts 11, 25 through 26. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year they met with the church and taught a great people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. So who are disciples? Well, they're Christians. One of my wife and I's favorite pastors is John Piper. Piper breaks down the term discipleship into two categories. Category one, discipleship he defines as my own pattern of following Jesus. We see evidence of this in John 8, 31 through 32. So Jesus said to the Jews who believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciple, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." The if statement in that passage of Scripture is this: if you abide in my word, then we can be confident in the following: you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So if being a disciple involves abiding in his word, how do we do that practically today? Does that literally mean devote ourselves to only reading the word? I don't know about you, but if that is the case, I'm probably in trouble. Of course, we as disciples are called to be in the word, to study the word. I hold the conviction that this should be a daily thing for all of us. And this is an obvious thing for most of us, right? I know from talks I have at the small group I go to at Eric's house that I'm not the only one that has realized that when I take studying the word seriously and I spend time in the word day in and day out, not only is my walk with Christ improved, but my relationships with others are improved, and my overall attitude is improved. As I'm sure all of you know, I coach basketball. I say it's a hobby of mine. My wife tells me it's more of an obsession. Regardless, I often tell my players this: you as an individual player are either getting better or worse every single day. It's impossible to stay the same. When it comes to not just reading the word, but all the spiritual disciplines that pastor has taught on, the same, I believe, is true. We're either becoming a better disciple of Christ or a worse disciple of Christ. The reality is it takes work, it takes time, and of course it takes the grace of God. So that's category one. Category two of discipleship, Piper also defines it as my activity helping others to become disciples of Christ. Piper takes his second definition or category of discipleship, and he breaks it into two subcategories. So the first subcategory is this: sharing the gospel for the conversion of souls. If you look at Acts 14, 19 through 21. Now, the focus of this is going to be verse 21, but 19 and 20 are way too good to skip, so we're going to read them too. "But the Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, and having persuaded the crowds, they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing that he was dead. But when the disciples gathered him up, gathered about him, he rose up and entered the city. And on the next day, he went on with Barnabas to Derbe. Now pause here for a moment. Are you like me, wishing you had the determination and resilience of Paul? Like, that should be our prayer. The man was literally stoned within an inch of his life. And what does he do? Well, we're going to learn in verse 21 that he continued to share the very message that had caused him to get stoned just one day earlier. So picking up in 21. When they had preached the gospel to that city and had made many disciples, they returned to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch. So what was the mission for Paul and Barnabas here in Acts? Sorry, I lost my spot. It was to share the gospel and see the lost saved. We learn from the text in this case that Paul and Barnabas did share the gospel, but then they did what? They returned where they had come from. Today, this is often called evangelism, and it's really important. It's a clear calling for all Christians. Scripture makes it abundantly clear, time and time again, that we are called to share the gospel with the lost. It should be our mission by all means necessary. It is vital to the life of the disciple of Christ. If we aren't sharing, then how can we say we love others? I often personally struggle with this reality, like I'm sure some of you do. I have family members, close friends, who are lost, who need the love of Christ, and I don't do enough. We should, like Paul, be so convicted and determined to share that we won't even let literal stones being hurled at us stop us from doing whatever it takes to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. So that would be subcategory one. Piper goes on further in his second subcategory and defines discipleship as meaning the entire process. So conversion, baptism, and teaching of the word. Those that are come to youth group and are in here, I know if I ask them what conversion, baptism, and teaching of the world, they would be able to define it to me as sanctification, right, Spencer? Without a doubt. We have worked really hard on the term sanctification. But that's what it really is if you sum that up into one word. So we read again, as I referenced earlier, in Matthew 28, 19 through 20, that we as disciples of Jesus Christ are commanded by him to go ye therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you to the end of the age. So as you can see, Jesus does instruct his followers to not only proclaim the gospel and make disciples, because we now know disciple is just a Christian, but he instructs them further to then baptize them, and then his third instruction is to teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. Now the last one's obviously going to take some time, right? True discipleship is not the drive-through process at McDonald's. We can't complete the process of discipleship in a simple two-window stop process. It's not that easy. The reality of life is that we influence people around us. How we live, how we act, what we say, what we do is seen by others, and it allows them to form opinions of us. I often apply this truth to basketball. I'll say the following to my players. I'm always watching. I'm watching if you hustle back on defense. I'm watching if you're talking while you're on the floor. I'm watching if you put the basketballs on the rack at the end of practice. I'm watching your attitude when you're on the bench. And it's true. As a coach, I do watch these things and many others, and it helps me form my depth chart. It helps me understand how I can trust various players during various times of the game of basketball. And the same is true about our daily lives, how we act, what we say, what we do allows others to form opinions of us. And those opinions either improve our ability to play our role in the discipleship-making process, or they hinder our ability to play our role in the discipleship-making process. The reality is we're influencing those around us for better or worse. As Christians, we are either being encouraging disciples, or we are moving in the wrong direction and potentially dragging others down with us. All right, last basketball analogy, I promise. What I meant by playing our role is essentially our ability to be a good discipleship-making teammate within the church. As I was preparing what I was going to share today, I couldn't help but begin to reflect on my own discipleship process throughout my life. I couldn't help but think of the good teammates that had played their role in discipling me well. Naturally, I first thought of my parents that had committed to having me at church nearly every single opportunity growing up. I thought back to a particular Sunday night. My dad and I were huge Packer fans growing up, and the Packers were playing in the NFC Championship game. And it was the height of Brett Favre's career. He was our favorite quarterback of all time. And my parents, instead of just allowing me to stay home and watch the game, encouraged me and influenced me to put on my Favre jersey, go to Sunday night church, and maybe just say a prayer that he wouldn't throw another season-ending interception. And the prayers were not answered, but that's not the point. I was at church that Sunday night. I thought back to all the Sunday school lessons that were taught by Aunt Gay or by Peggy, or the 8 years, because I wouldn't leave, the 8 years I spent with my grandfather in Sunday school. I thought back to the years spent in youth group with Uncle Craig. A lot of Sunday nights it was only myself, my sister, and the triplets, but Uncle Craig didn't seem to care. He kept coming, and he kept pouring into our lives. I reflected deeply on how a group of young Christian men sought me out and helped disciple me in a way that pulled me out of the darkest days of my life after I'd made a lot of very poor choices as a freshman in college. I reflect now on how many of you in this very room bring the reality of the gospel to my life daily. Whether it is my wife, our pastor, or coworkers, the point is God has graciously surrounded me with individuals that disciple me daily. I'm very grateful to be a team member of Nelsonville Assembly of God. I'm grateful for the many different people that God has used and is still using to disciple me. The idea of being a good teammate or playing our role of discipleship in the church is found all over Scripture. You see in Titus 2:4, so train the young women to love their husbands and children. 2 Timothy 2:2, what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Ephesians 6:4, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. Matthew 28:20, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. Hebrews 3:13, but exhort one another every day as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. 1 Peter 4:10, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's very grace. Deuteronomy 6:5-9, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall speak them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them as you sit at your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be on the frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. So I began today by outlining how unqualified I am to be standing in the pulpit. Like I said, I'm not a pastor. I'm a sinner saved by grace whom God has called to be a disciple. All of you in this room that have placed your faith in Christ alone are in the same boat as me. We are commanded by Christ to be part of the discipleship of others and ourselves. So how do we practically do discipleship? For this message, I've broken down discipleship into three forms of application. Number one, every Christian should be helping non-believers become believers. That's the starting point. Should be our goal day in and day out. So how do we practically do this? Well, we start by sharing the gospel with the lost people around us, the people that we go to work with, the relatives that we have. We spend time praying for lost souls around us and around the world. We do our part in giving to missions work. And when called, we actively participate in missions work. Application point number two, every Christian should be helping other Christians be more like Christ. We do this by engaging with Christians about Christian things outside of the hours of 9:30 to noon on Sunday. We engage in things like small groups. As I was preparing this message, I was thinking what a blessing the small group my wife and I attends has been for us. It's been specifically neat for our lives that we've been blessed to be a part of a group of young parents that help prepare us to become parents. Another practical way that you can disciple other believers is just share a meal with them. Invite them over to your house. I wasn't very comfortable with this before I met my wife. I'm a pretty reserved individual when it comes to my home time, I guess. But my wife was quick to take that away. She's very outgoing, and it is nothing for my wife to invite somebody over to have a meal, and it sometimes makes me uncomfortable, but I'm getting more comfortable with it. And that should be something that we do. We go to church with each other on Sunday. We should be able to sit around a table and talk about it on Tuesday night. In the third application, every Christian should be actively seeking guidance from other Christians to become a better follower of Christ. We should be seeking the wisdom of more Christians around us. My fellow educators in the room, I'm sure, are familiar with the phrase lifelong learner. Pretty sure it's a requirement on all resumes for educators. The idea is more important when it comes to our spiritual maturity. If we aren't actively seeking the guidance and wisdom of more mature Christians around us, then we're missing out on a direct gift from our Father in heaven. I do not think any of us would say that we can become too sanctified. This side of heaven, it's impossible for us to make it spiritually. That is why it is so vital we tap into the godly counsel that surrounds us every day. This can be older Christians or younger Christians. That's not the point. The point is we are to live in a community actively working to disciple one another in order that we all become more like Christ and bring glory to his name. Now, my last point of application is apart from those three, and it's something that my wife and I feel the Lord has really laid on our hearts personally. We have a true desire to see the youth of this church take ownership of their faith. My wife was raised Catholic and came to know Christ through a Protestant youth group she attended. I personally experienced the benefit as I grew up in this very church. We are committed to discipling the youth in this church, as many as we can. As educators, we both understand the importance of the teen years. On a personal level for me, I strongly believe that had it not been for the foundation work that was completed in my spiritual walk through my time participating in Christian youth-oriented activities, I would not have had the convictions I felt from the Holy Spirit that redirected my life in college. I was headed down the wide road of worldliness, but God's love and grace redirected my path, and he did so through the constant presence of conviction that I know would not have been there had it not been for the time others spent investing in my spiritual life as a teenager. My wife and I realized the busyness of teen years. I know that teens' attentions are being drawn in a million different directions. I work with them every single day. But I would not be following the lead of Christ this morning if I did not implore every youth and every parent of youth in here to prioritize their faith above all else. It's truly the only thing that will last. Nothing else drawing the attention of teenagers has the internal impact that church does. Not hanging with friends, not school, not work, and not sports. Obviously, those things are good. And teenagers should engage with their peers. They should study hard. They should work hard. And they should participate in athletics. But not at the cost of their personal relationship with Christ. That has to be number one, and our God frankly demands it. When Christ is number one in a teen's life, like all believers' lives, it enhances all other aspects of their daily life. This is my strong belief because I've experienced it both personally and I've witnessed it firsthand as teenagers have lived it out in front of my eyes. In this extremely dark world that kids now have to wake up and face every day, Jesus is their only hope they have to overcome what Satan is attacking them with. Believe me, I see it every day. Kids are exposed to more evil and sin than at any time in history. And the power of positive thinking or any other man-made solution is not going to work. The kids of today, like all people today, desperately need Christ at the center of their lives. Not only is it vital for teens as individuals, but it's vital for the church as a whole. If we as the church are not committed to point into the next generation, we will surely see the church as a whole move away from the truth of the word. However, I can assure you, the Lord will bless his church as a whole, and specifically, he will bless this church locally if we commit to intentionally pouring into the lives of our youth and encouraging them to take true ownership of their faith. It's my wife and I's prayer. It's our desire that our son will reap the benefits of a church that is committed to his spiritual development during his teenage years. Now, hear me when I say, I realize it's hard. I realize that being a faithful follower of Christ is often work. I know that applying all of these various ways of practicing discipleship often means sacrificing me time, which is something that somehow our culture has spun in a positive light. Like, me time is this positive thing. I tend to disagree. But, brothers and sisters, hear me when I say it's so worth it. The time in which God has graciously allowed me to see the fruits of discipleship in my life are some of the greatest moments I've had on earth. They even trump the big wins on the basketball court. But I get it. Our sinful nature, the selfishness that is deeply woven within the natural state of me and all sinners, is something that is often relentless. Apart from the work of the Spirit, we fail. But Christian, you and I know that the power of Christ is living in us. The Holy Spirit is sufficient to equip us to take part in all aspects of discipleship. And I conclude with this. Bottom line, we are put on this earth to glorify our Creator. As Christians, this is our sole purpose. So how do we do that day in and day out? Well, a huge part of it is our active participation in discipleship. Like I said, being a disciple is being a Christian, and it's evidence of our salvation. It's the fruit that Jesus is talking about in the parable of the vine in John 15, 1 through 6. He says in verse 4, "Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me." Friends, our participation in all aspects of discipleship is that fruit that bears witness of our faith in Christ. That is something important, and that is something that is commanded of us as Christians. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this church. I thank you for this body of believers. I thank you that you have called us to be disciples. I pray that you would give us all discernment to know who around us we are to be pouring into daily, and I pray you would also give us discernment to know who we are to seek out for guidance and growth. Jesus, I thank you for the work that you did on the cross. And I pray that you would go with us from this place and empower us through your Spirit to be true disciples of Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray, and everybody said, amen.
As we do every week, we're going to take a few minutes to respond to this. So worship team, if you'll come this morning, we're going to have another song. We're going to have the altar area open here if you want to come and you want to pray. What Reed just shared, the importance of discipleship, is important for each one of us. All of us are called to this. These 3 points: to evangelize, to disciple others, and to be growing personally. So here's what I know to be true. Here's what Reed would know to be true, and I'm just not going to make him say it. You're strong probably in a few of these areas, and you're weak somewhere else. And you might think that that's hidden behind the things you're doing and the activities of your life, but it's, one, known to God, who knows everything about you, and two, it's known to those around you. So today, what we're saying is, okay, listen, here's what it means to be discipled. You're going to need to be pouring into others, you need to be being poured into, and you need to be sharing the gospel with other people. And what's true is that everyone in this room is not doing something on that list well. So we're going to say, let's respond to the Lord. To his word this morning, let's pray. Let's repent of our sinfulness, of maybe like you said, it's the me time, the desire for, you know, I don't want to do those things because I work hard and I've got a lot going on. And I just, you know, when I have the opportunity, I'd rather not. We're all going to have the opportunity to repent here. And since everyone in this room's failing somewhere on the list here, there's no judgment when you respond today. No one else is going to be surprised. No one else is going to sit there in their pew and go, wow, I can't believe that person would admit that they're not being a full-on, completely committed disciple. So let's take a few minutes to respond. We're going to sing. We're going to worship. We're going to pray. We're going to repent. And we're going to ask the Lord to help us live as true disciples, understand the importance of discipleship. Let's worship together. Lord, we sing that song because that really is the solution. We need you. We need more of you. No matter how long ago it is we began our journey with you, no matter how long ago we became a Christian, no matter what our background looks like, the solution for this moment, for right now, is more of you. So we just ask that you would pour out your love and your grace and your spirit upon us, that we would walk as faithful disciples. We repent, Lord, of these areas, whichever area it has been, or all these areas perhaps, Lord. We repent now of the sin that has held us back from living as a disciple ought to live. And we ask, Lord, that you change us and you make us into the disciples you would have us be. That as we have more and more of you, as we build our relationship with you every day through the word, abiding in your word, that that would change us. And that we would be faithful disciples who live out discipleship in our lives and the lives of others every single day. We thank you for your love. We thank you for the gift of this day and the opportunity to grow. It's in your beautiful, powerful name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Before you leave, let me just say once again, thank you, Reed, for sharing the word this morning. Proud of you. Not only being a disciple who's eager to grow and learn, but to pour into others. Amen. Have a great afternoon. Ladies, tonight, 6 o'clock here at the church. Have a wonderful afternoon. We'll see you this evening.